What's up? What's up? It's me. It's me. It's the LEEBOY TV. I'm here on the Prime Nostalgia Podcast. I got my guy Prime. You guys should know him. Say what's up to the people, Prime.
Hey, if y'all don't know me by now, then
what are you doing here?
Yeah. What are you doing here? I'm here every week. You don't notice me. I'm sorry. I try to stand out more.
And then we got a special guest today. Somebody I've known for years and years. Actually, I think I was on his first project he even got started with. This guy's been doing, he's a nostalgia king. He's been on Disney Channel. The guy been on Fat Albert. We're gonna get through everything. Oh, we talk about Great Debaters, Jersey. I know I got the IMDb. I got the memo stacking up. My guy, Jermaine Williams. Say what's up to the people, man. What's up?
Hey, what's going on, peoples? My Prime Nostalgia family. What's happening? What's good with y'all, man? Thanks.
Hey. What's up, man?
What's happening?
Man, we happy to have you, bro. You're looking good. I see on your IG talking about you losing some weight, shedding some.
Bro, look, man, look, it's about the it's skincare. You know what I mean? Skincare, weight loss. You know, everyone, everyone. I'm like I feel like I'm kind of like a guru now. Like everyone, drink your water. Your 100 plus ounces of water.
Did they tell you you changed yet?
What's up?
Did they tell you you changed yet? How was your Thanksgiving?
It's a dramatic change, man. To be honest with you, man, the last couple projects that I that's been aired, I filmed like either last year or late last year, and I was 35 plus pounds, and it's weird. It's kind of odd to see me watch those projects because I don't look the same at all. And you know, but I'm proud of my growth, proud of the process. I got a little ways to go, you know what I mean? But all I'm doing now is just more so encouraging people, you know, to live life as healthy as possible, you know. And basically I was just inspired by my kids, you know, and not being able to keep up with my son. He's all over the place and I'm winded and I don't like that. I don't like the feeling of being winded. I don't like to run anyway. I'm not a big runner, you know. I don't like that feeling in your chest.
Right. Especially like when your son's running in the street and you got to
get him. Like after 5 minutes, you like, who shot you? Who shot you? Who shot me?
Oh, man.
For real.
Yeah, that was I had a similar experience. It's because my kids, I lost about 75, bro. Like I was doing it, but them kids will make you change. Not only, you know, you want to live a longer and healthier life, but like you're saying, just wanted to be able to play, you know, and just feel good and feel natural. So,
and it's as simple as that sound. It's literally like, yeah, just play with your kids. But if you're out of shape, like, you can't do it. Like you literally
and catch the ball and
yeah,
you can't even touch your toes damn near. Like,
you can't see your toes.
All right, so just starting off, man, just because, you know, we do primarily nostalgia on the podcast, I wanted to touch on a couple projects that you had, actually, with some All That cast members. You've been in, we already talked about Fat Albert with Keenan. Mm-hmm. He was on Great Debaters with Denzel Whitaker, who was an All That cast member. And me and you, we were on Bulwark together.
We were on Bulwark together, and I'm really good friends with Giovanni Samuels, man. Like that's sis right there. So yeah, I haven't never worked with her professionally, but we talk on a regular basis for sure.
Now she's real cool. So yeah, we just saw her out in Atlanta actually.
I saw pictures, man. Yeah. Y'all look good.
So Bulwark though, you know, I've been it's been coming up a little bit just because of the comparisons Joe Biden to Bulwark. Have you been getting any crazy fan questions or anything? And I think you did mention that you were on that project recently.
Absolutely.
Has anything coming up for you?
It was crazy. I think it's streaming somewhere. I'm not sure if it's Hulu or Netflix, but an actress friend of mine named DeAndra, I just recently worked with, while we were on set in a project in New Orleans, she actually streamed it. And out of nowhere, she took a picture of me on screen at like 12 years old doing Bulwark, which was an awesome project to work on, written and directed by Warren Beatty. And it was a really, really fun process. Even just the audition process was fun. I originally auditioned for the little gangsters that worked under Don Cheadle's character. And honestly, I think all of us are discussed. Honestly, and the thing is, it's the funny thing about it was the dialogue was just pure cussing.
Right. It literally, I used to love that stuff as a kid.
It was pure cussing the whole time. And it was like, if you ever had the opportunity to cuss, this was the opportunity. As a 12-year-old, if you had the opportunity to cuss, this was the perfect opportunity in an audition room where your brother, where your mom and your dad didn't have to, you know, ridicule you for cussing. They pretty much encourage you, go ahead and get this job. You got to do what? Cuss? Do it. Do it. This is your open door of opportunity.
Hey, and you landed the role too. Like, was that your first role?
Well, that was my first movie project I had ever done. I did maybe a couple of commercials before that.
Yeah, those won't show up on IMDb. Yeah,
not at all. Yeah, but that was, yes, my first major movie role, and I didn't get hired for the gangster. I was kind of like, they was like, it gave me another role as the kid in the house watching the debate or the interview. You know what I mean? I guess I didn't cuss well enough. You know,
right?
Who was that? Arthur A.G. and the twins was in it, right?
Jermaine and Gerard, mixing boys.
Yeah, right. They got the gangster roles. So they were doing all the cussing, and I think I had one line, and I was damn. And that was just improv. I think Warren, but he said, "Hey, Jermaine, just say damn right here. Just say damn." And I was like, "Damn!" That's about all the cussing I really got in for real.
Well, you did better than me. I don't think I had a line. I know I was up there the whole time.
Yeah, I mean, we was kicking it for days. Like, they had us up there for days. You know what I mean? Different locations, and you know, mm-hmm. I remember they had a soundstage for the house. They built up like a. The fake house inside the soundstage that looked hella real, and that was cool for me. That was my first time ever seeing like a fake house on set on a soundstage. And I said, at 12, you just stupid. You're like, yo, how they move this house inside this soundstage? I literally thought that, like, how you move this house in the soundstage?
And we picked it up and brought it over here. That's how.
Yeah, like, how did they move it? This is literally because the house they duplicated was literally off of, I want to say off of Figueroa. And no, that wasn't Figueroa. That was Broadway. Broadway and Martin Luther King, which is, if any of y'all know, it's like South Central LA, right around
the corner. Definitely South Central, yeah.
It was like right around the corner from USC. And it was like, man, how did they move that house? And then when I went back in the neighborhood, the house was back to where its original place was. I said, oh, they moved it back. They moved it back.
Bro, I told you need to do stand-up, bro. We already talked about this.
But, man. I like to play, man. I'm a fool, man. You already know.
But yeah, so we got on cussing, just like me. You know, we didn't get to the cursing role, but, you know, it got us in the door, you know.
Right.
We some badass kids, I guess. But so I just, you know, one of your major roles, I'm gonna say right now, I was definitely envious, was when you were in Great Debaters, because obviously you got to work with Denzel, all the greats. A lot of people, you could talk about the people behind the scenes as well that helped produce those projects, because I know, you know, that was a star-studded event. It was a moment in time for sure. And like I said, I was jealous. Can you just talk about what it was like to be around, you know, that aura, and for you to, like, because you had a major role in there, man. You definitely carried, you know, parts of the movie. In fact, just talk about what it was like stepping up and being around the greats like that.
I appreciate that, man. I appreciate the compliments, and, you know, honestly, man, it was it was surreal. Even talking about it still to this day is still surreal. And we're able to build up some memories I could talk for a lifetime. You know what I mean? The movie was produced by, Denzel definitely has some producer credit for producing it. Oprah Winfrey, of course, Todd Black. And honestly, man, it was one of those roles when I first got the size and got the audition, I claimed it like right there.
That's important, right?
I claimed it on the spot. I said, I have got to get this role. And is strenuous of, you know, I don't even want to say I went into just training. I just wanted to make sure that I had these lines down packed, my speech well spoken during the audition. And okay. It was actually my first period piece I'd ever done. I'd never done a period piece before. And I knew I had to kind of get outside of myself, knowing that this was based in the 1930s. So I would just focus, man. It was just a time. It was just a really, really time for me to focus on, I feel like, such an important project that I think that was a story that needed to be told to the world. And to be honest with you, man, walking in that room and meeting Denzel for the first time, it was surreal. You know, I remember we had, and thing is, I was up against some heavy hitting people. Like, right. I went to this room, I said, oops, I'm going up against him. At a point, you're like, I don't have a chance. I don't have a chance of getting this role. That's exactly how you feel. And we're all in one group. And it's like, you know, we're all in there. Everybody knows each other. Everybody says hi to each other. And you get Denzel to walk out. It's my first time seeing him. And he introduces himself. Hey, guys, I'm Denzel Washington. It's as if we don't know who he is. Like, you know, brother. Beyond encouraging for us to just do our best and shoot our shot for the role. And we get in the room, and then, like, well, once he came out to introduce himself, I believe a bit of the pressure kind of went away a little bit, so I was able to get my you know, my focus element. And then when you walk in the room, that nervousness gets back up again, because Denzel is, he's an artist, man. Like, he's so passionate about his craft. And when I tell you, he literally looked through my soul, and just kind of like, it was one of those situations where he played, like, I did my lines and I thought that was it. And he was like, no, we about to play. And it's like one of those situations where he just goes off the riff and just improvises with you. And he wants you to build your world, your character, where you're from, right there on the spot. And you literally have to just be fast on your feet and just come up and play back and forth with him. And as scary as that was, you know, it was one of the most iconic moments in my life, knowing that I was able to play back and forth, you know, with Denzel Washington. And then plus, of course, the scene I was able to do at the dinner table with him, confronting him about, you know, his methods of teaching. That was also an honor, you know. So working with Nate Parker, come on, man. My man Nate, working with him was amazing. Journey, of course, and Denzel Whitaker. It was probably one of the most professional sets I'd ever really done, and one of probably the most dramatic films I'd ever done as well. And I'm just blessed and grateful to say I was able to be a part of something so great, for sure.
Dope.
Yeah, man. And I mean, like you said, it sounds like Denzel really tested you, and really proved absolutely. Yourself as a character. Like, you can put on a real character and make it believable. You really became a character, man. Actor in that. Was that the epitome of you showing those skills? Have you done that? Like, just for the people to, like, get more familiar with your content, have you put yourself out there in another character like that? Because that was real strong, because it was somewhat like you, but it's really nothing like you. Like,
I've always been just a comedic guy. And to be honest with you, that was my first, I want to say, serious dramatic role I'd ever took on. And even doing the role of Hamilton Burgess, you know, I tried to find the lightness, the comedy of him. And if you watch it again, you'll see that I was very playful with my character, but I had to tone it down a lot, because I'm very big with comedy, especially with my face. I make a lot of big faces, big eyes, I'm a character's actor. If you're comparing, like, let's say the role I played iPod in The Comebacks, or even Mushmouth, is just broadly all comic, like a comic book. And this tested me to hone that comedy and, I guess, give it at certain times and muffle it down to a certain degree. And of course, you know, Denzel knew of my work and was like, man, you're funny. You know, he goes, use that comedy. Let's just bring it down and settle it. You know what I mean? He said, I want you to use it. It's about timing. When to use it, not to use it, when to be serious. And, you know, and you speak of the 1930s. It was a very, very serious time, you know, in our era. And it was not so great time for Black people.
Yeah,
and, you know, even to this day, we're still fighting for justice and rights. I'm on a debate team. So whatever I'm arguing about, I have to be very serious and poignant about everything that I'm speaking of, especially when it comes to the culture and, you know, us as a people. You know, so I just try to grab and gravitate to that seriousness and that toneness. And I have a greater appreciation for drama now that I've done that. I actually want more drama roles now, you know, as well as comedy, but I love doing drama now. I even write dramatic stuff now, you know, more serious stuff. So yeah, man, it's something that attached to me, and I will forever, man, be grateful for sure.
Yeah, man. Prime, you want to take us into ask him something about actually, you know what? I think we should save that part for after. If you haven't seen Bullworth, if you haven't seen Great Debaters, get in tune with those projects, because even though they took place, 10-15 years ago, and we're talking nostalgia now, both of the storylines, both of the concepts in those movies are very important today. It's something that you can definitely learn from today, very relevant. And Jermaine does, he has a great role in both of them. Well, not so much in Bullworth. He was just both kids. Hey, but that dam was important.
You got people watching him like, where is this food?
Hey, that dam was kind of important after he said he was going to kill, what did he say, kill everybody?
He said kill all of them.
Get rid of all the white people.
Get all the white people. And she was like, all of them? He's like, all of them. I'm like,
I think he said that everybody just fuck until there's no more white people. I think.
Right. That's what he said.
Yeah. So not kill them off, sex them off.
I just want Jermaine to put his PNP jersey on because we want to talk about jersey a little bit.
Okay.
Yeah, we can talk about jersey a little bit. I would say for the type of show that it was, I would say it's a good concept for that time. Like you put a jersey on, and then you like in the whatever the jersey is basically taking place. I don't know. I just thought it was like that's a good kid show for that time.
I'm gonna be honest with you, though. I think it's a dope concept now. I'll be honest with you.
Yeah, but you know, ain't nobody gonna really pay money. You know, the actual teams ain't gonna pay money. To do that,
you never know, man. I'll be honest with you. I'm actually in the process of writing a reboot movie, to be honest with you. I'll be honest with you. I'm in the process of writing. I was a bit salty and in my feelings a little bit that we weren't on Disney Plus.
Why is that? You don't know?
I don't know. Okay. I mean, you got all these shows, but the jersey ain't on there. Now, I do get a lot of feedback about that. Of why it isn't on Disney Plus is one of my favorite shows. Even the famous Jet Jackson isn't even on there. Rest in peace to Lee Thompson Young. Mm-hmm. But both shows were amazing, you know. But they got everything else on there, plus a lot of, you know, today's shows
and stuff that's not even Disney too. Yeah,
yeah. Things that they got a couple shows I would like that still ain't on there, but those are cartoons too. But like, there's still a lot of, they could add on there, like Netflix adds every couple of months or whatever. They could still add stuff, but
I agree. Hey. But it definitely inspired me to want to write, you know, a concept reboot for the show. And unfortunately, we lost a great person, an actor, and Michael Gagliotta, who played the lead character, Nick Leiter, on the show. Rest in peace. Yeah. I wanted to not only do a reboot, but honor him in the same fashion. With the reboot, you know, making good light of his name and his character. It was just an honor. It was a great show to be on. It's my first series that I'd ever been a part of ever. And that's what definitely kickstarted my career as a young actor. So,
and yeah, I mean, we got to get on Disney Plus, especially about famous Jet Jackson. I ain't going to just skip over the jersey like that. But y'all better get Jet Jackson together. Beyonce.
Let's be honest. Let's be honest. Y'all familiar with Casey Undercover, right? That's literally like the female version of
basically. Jet
basically it's basically almost the same thing. And as much as I love Casey Undercover as well, man, it's a great show.
Y'all heard it here first. Y'all get the jersey and the damn Jet Jackson on Disney Plus. All right, we're gonna put the fire on them. Y'all heard it straight here from PNP. What you got, Brian?
If you can do that for not sports things like comedy shows or movies, what would three jerseys be?
Three of my favorite jerseys.
I'm talking about like if you had to put a jersey on to go into a stand-up special or a movie.
He's asking you for non-sport. So if you could just put on something,
I could go into a non-sport. Yeah.
Like put on Eddie Murphy leather pants for Raw or something.
You crazy? I'm gonna be honest with you, man. If I had the chance to, I would have wanted to go back and be a part of the audience of Dave Chappelle's HBO special, Killing Me Softly.
Oh, that's a good one.
Killing Me Softly. Hands down, one of my favorite stand-up comedy shows of all time, bro. As much as I love Dave Chappelle now, that for me was the one that just signified his place as not only one of the funniest men, period, but that's what just kind of like set like a footprint for like his walk towards his greatness for me.
Is there a certain song you want us to play during the break, Jermaine?
A certain song?
Yeah.
Anything J Dilla or Tribe Called Quest, I'm down for it.
Okay.
Hey.
Well. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, we will be right back after this break.
Hey.
I might as well just put this in for the break then. Did y'all see Nate Robinson get knocked out?
That was going to be my... We back from the break. That was my comeback because it was a little nostalgia with Mike Tyson and Roy Jones. So we'll get to that next. But Nate with the booty out? Oh, Lord. He had his booty, stinking booty all in the air.
I think I was more hilarious. And I know it probably hurt, but the face down first. Like his head went... face down, like it was like the head and the body followed.
And he ended up in like this position, like, like, God,
he buckled. And then somebody had noticed, they said his head was facing the opposite direction of his feet, so that was it was actually kind of jacked up. His feet and his head, his feet was this way, and his head, it was bad. Oh. I'll be honest with you, and what makes it worse is he's the one that called that dude out.
Yeah.
Yes. Like, bro, at least go in there with some kind of skill, because you made that white boy look like hella tough.
Mm-hmm.
Hella tough. And the thing is, Nate Robinson, like, he looked like he had, like, an advantage at the beginning. Like, he had, like, some really swift feet work. And I guess, like, he had this feet work, but a brother, I guess he don't know what blocking is.
With the head,
yeah, you don't know what defense is. Yeah, right.
I was like, find your inner Mayweather, brother.
He had the Knicks colors on, so what a better representation than getting knocked out.
Mmm. Ooh, that's a bad deal.
Sorry.
With the NY.
Sorry, Nick.
Shots fired.
What? And you're what? You a Magic fan or what, Brian?
No, nah. You know what? I can't even lie. I like OKC. Can't even lie.
Yeah, well, he's been training, I think, pretty seriously for the last 2 years, trying to, you know, bait people into fights. He obviously baited Nate Robinson, didn't turn out well for him. What has inspired you to progress your career from just being on screen to working behind the scenes and looking to actually create your own projects?
Inspiration comes when you're not booking stuff. We don't book.
Yeah.
Be honest with you. It's pretty much the number one recipe for people quitting their dreams as an actor or looking for something along the same lines in the industry to, you know, exceed and excel in. That was my inspiration, you know. In this industry, it goes by seasons. You know what I'm saying? Some people have longer seasons than others. People get great seasons early in their career. Some people get them later in their career. You just never know. There's no guarantees in this industry. But if you love the industry as much as I do, as far as just the artistic side of it, I love it. I feel like if I'm not getting hired in things that people are writing or I'm going on auditions for, that can definitely get old, where you're sitting by a phone waiting for a phone call, waiting for your next audition. Things get slow. You don't audition, you don't book. And when you do book, you know, you're grateful, but those bookings sometimes just come so far in between. And I felt, you know what? I'd rather create. I'd rather put myself in something that I see myself in, creating myself, producing myself. And at that point, the work is limitless. You're providing yourself with work. You know what I'm saying? Not even that, you're providing art to viewers and people who will give you credibility of your talent, of the pen, you know, and your talent in front and behind the scenes. So I was definitely inspired just by not being able to book as often as I wish I could have. So that's what made me, you know.
I felt like you was talking to me and you was like, some people quit. Like, I know I quit. A big part of it was the audition process. It's not really a process that I really liked. I am a big fan of the art. And I always say, hey, I'll get into a project if somebody just offered me a role, but I ain't trying to get in there and audition and all that. What do you have that some of those same feelings about auditioning versus the art?
Absolutely, man. I mean, I put like this, man. You get older, you get smarter. And it gets to the point where some of these projects, especially the bigger budget ones, where they write a particular character, productions already know who they want to hire. Mm. And they're going to shoot to try and book that person first. Somebody in my position, I'm always the second option, third option, fourth option, whatever the case may be. I'm always at the bottom of the totem pole. You know, when every production is always going to try and find the A-list actor first. And then they'll trickle down the line of people that they have. And it can get old, man. I totally get it. I've totally had those feelings. I've had feelings quite a few times in my career where I wanted to quit, you know. And when times got rough, you know, I would go out, get a job outside the industry. And there's nothing else I love doing better, man. I found myself doing other things and I was miserable. Period. As soon as I found myself in front of the camera, that's where my passion is. Like, that's where I found most joy of doing what I love is in front of the camera or writing or producing, whatever the case. As long as in the world of filmmaking, that's where I'm supposed to be.
Okay, when you said you was the second man, I was imagining that list ahead of you, and one of those people that has to be on that list ahead of you, and this is, you know, credit, no discredit to anyone or credit to anyone, is Kenan Thompson. He has to be, you guys have to be on one of those same lists where, hey, I'm going to choose these guys. If I can't get Kenan, I'm going to hit up Jermaine. And then, so do you think that's true? Have you ever seen him on any auditions? And what was it like to work with him in Fat Albert? We could just go into that afterwards.
Kenan Thompson, man, hands down, one of the funniest, just naturally funniest people I've ever worked with. When I say naturally funniest, what I mean is he's so naturally funny, it's effortless. Damn.
Mm-hmm.
Working on Fat Albert was a joy. Working on Fat Albert, man, was probably the most kid-like experience I've ever had. Only reason why is literally we were grown men being able to act like kids the whole time. We played, we joked, we came up with music, raps. We just played the whole 2.5 months we was on that.
And that was a dope cast of like all the young black brothers that was coming up at the time.
Absolutely, like, man.
All those guys.
And we all just, we had such a good time doing that project because it was just pure fun every single day. There was really no restrictions, to be honest with you. There was really no restrictions. We just was able to play our physical comedy, our mental comedy, smart comedy. The whole time, and just working with Kenan was a joy. The simple fact, I watched him growing up, you know, all that, you know, Kenan and Kale. I watched Kenan and Kale do their thing for years, and having an opportunity to work with him, it was an honor, man. And he's actually, like I said, one of the funniest, naturally funniest, effortlessly funny cats I've ever worked with, for sure. Dumb. Shout out to Kenan.
And I remember what I was going to ask you before. Look, I'm all over the place. Sorry, you guys, if it's a little bit out of order. But you were talking about, you know, just your feelings about the industry. And I wanted to ask you about your project, The Biz. Unfortunately, I was looking to watch it. I couldn't find it. So maybe you could tell people where to check it out and then a little bit about what it's about. Because it seemed like something like a B-list comedy, B-list actor, like a comedies. I'm not sure because I didn't see it. So just tell the people a little bit about it and where they can check it out.
Yeah, man. The Biz was a little web series that myself, RJ Smith, and Brandon Hammond produced.
Dope.
We also created it. Me and RJ created the concept. Basically, it was about just being a struggling actor in the biz, man. The hardships that they go through, being able to try to balance auditioning and holding a 9-to-5 at the same time. It's a struggle, you know, and depending on your background, where it can be a struggle if you're from the suburbs, if you're broke, if you're from the hood, whatever the case may be. It can be a struggle if people don't recognize the talent that you have. You know, you do your best to try to, you know, portray whatever it is that you audition for the best way possible. And they always seem like they always choose somebody else. And it's always disappointing. And it just wanted to show just kind of like the disappointing side of the business is not always peaches and cream, glitz and glam. And we just tried to portray those hardships in the most comedic way, you know, ever. So if you do have the chance to check it out, man, It's a pretty nice look for sure.
Dope. And go ahead, Prime.
I was gonna say, weird enough, we did have RJ on the show, and when you was talking about your auditioning, that kind of reminded me of what he said about auditioning. Pretty much, he just said it's like getting naked in front of random people that you don't know, drop your drawers, and then picking them up after the audition's over. But yeah, it was similar.
Jermaine Face
was
like, I never did that audition. No, I didn't go to that.
I mean, that's a pretty strong description.
When you was talking about auditioning, it kind of sounded similar to what he was saying the audition process is like for him. So
yeah,
it's cool that y'all did something together.
For me, it's always been about controlling my nervousness. You know what I mean? But I've always been, of course, every audition hasn't been great by far. I've messed up so many, you know, quite a few auditions, but the ones that I do feel great about, it's always me about trying to control my nervousness or butterflies in my stomach and using that as a way to drive me to do great in the room. I actually feel like if I didn't have nerves or didn't have that nervousness, something wouldn't feel right about the audition. So I actually embrace it and I appreciate the nervousness that I do have because it actually helps me kind of just gives me the energy, you know, the adrenaline in the process of doing the role right there in the room. It helps me kind of like knock, you know, the audition out, you know, a lot. So I appreciate the nerves and everything like that. But yeah, it's one of those situations where in the process, you can't think about what the casting director or the producer or the director what they're thinking. You have to really just live that moment. You have to create your own space, and you have to focus on the character at hand, and you have to focus that you're portraying that character the best way you possibly can to get the role, you know. And it's weird how it's kind of like a light switch for me. It's always like a light switch. It's like you go in there, you slate, say your name, and you just switch it on, and you just focus, and you're in that character. You are that character until the end of the scene, and then from there, it's kind of like a you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. It's a relief because you know you were able to get through it. You know what I mean? So my draw stayed on.
Yeah. I kept mine on too, RJ. as far as you and RJ, though, y'all got a project together. Y'all was dropping some bars together that just recently got released, I think.
Okay. So
not too long ago.
So actually, it's a re-release. It's like a reboot of an album that me and RJ, we actually used to have a hip-hop group back in 2008, lasted till about 2011. We used to call ourselves Black OC. Shout out to RJ. Shout out to my boy Acapella Jones, Lorenzo. Okay. It was a trio. And actually, man, we were just, till this day, we're still hip hop heads. But, you know, we took our little stand doing music. And we released our first album, I want to say 2011, 2012. No, I'm sorry. That was like 2009, maybe 2010. And then RJ recently just gathered all that stuff together and just kind of just flipped it and just kind of like remixed all the tracks that we had did, you know what I mean? And RJ is a great producer, man. He comes up with awesome music. And I thought it sounded great. You know, he just took our old vocals and flipped them, switched them, and just remixed the whole album. And it sounds really good, man. So if you guys get a chance to hear it, please listen to it.
My multi-talented, multi-faceted brother. You doing them.
I got a few bars, you know what I'm saying?
A little something. Yeah, so man. What you got coming up, man? What can you tell the people about, or what would you tell the people to find you? Where would you tell them to find you?
Yeah, man, I'm on Instagram, man. I'm pretty active on Instagram. You know, if you want to reach out, message me, you know. If you do slide into a DM, I'm pretty good with responding. I'm very appreciative of anybody that appreciates my work. So anybody that shows love, I like to show love right back. You know what I mean? You can definitely reach me at The Real Jermaine Williams. Sorry, it ain't no the on it. Let me see it. It's Real Jermaine altogether _ Williams on Instagram. And type in my name on Facebook. I'm on Facebook as well. You know, so yeah, reach out. As of late, I just came back from doing a project for the Disney Channel called The Secrets of Sulphur Springs, which is a kid show. And if I wanted to describe it, it's a mixture of Back to the Future meets Stranger Things. It's pretty cool.
Okay.
It's pretty cool. It's actually not your typical Disney Channel show. And it has it's a sense of realism. It's not silly at all. You know, it definitely has some really heart to heart warm moments, and it has some sci-fi stuff that, you know. So I'm actually excited to see the project. I told my daughter about it. She's excited to see it. So definitely check it out. Secret of Sulphur Springs. And I think it drops at the beginning of 2021. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Dope. I mean, it sounds
If you haven't checked out Ratched, please check out Ratchet on Netflix. Great show. Great, great show. Shout out to Sarah Paulson. And
go find me, Lee Boy TV on IG, on YouTube, also on Twitter. Go check out my T Public store. Go check out my my Hemp Smart store. Go get the CBD, get your joints right. If you feeling anything like Nate this morning, make sure you get right on hempsmart.com/LeeBoyTV. And where can they find you, Prime? Also, go check out our last episode with Christy if you didn't see that. Keenan, just a couple episodes ago, we got some dope stuff. Obviously, you're here with Jermaine. So, yeah, we keeping it bubbling, y'all. We bubbling. What you got, Prime?
Hey, just follow me on Twitter and Instagram at KVNG Primetime. And follow the podcast at Prime Nostalgia Pod. And that's it. Just stay on the lookout.
All right, y'all. That's all I got. I'm supposed to be working from home right now, so I got to get back to it.